Hello, so yes, I'm from Bulgaria. I'm an application architect. How many of you know that software has office in Bulgaria? Okay, nice. So today I'm going to talk about Microsoft technologies and big data, which is a dangerous topic. I hope you didn't bring any eggs with you today. So what I will try to convince you is that Microsoft and their cloud, public cloud Azure, now provides options for us, the .NET developers and not only, to build big data solutions, which is very nice. And as you know, cloud providers provide infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, so on. And I will focus more on a platform as a service solution. And I'll very briefly describe one business case that we have a real project and how we approach it with platform as a service. And it will unfortunately be very briefly because we have only 4 minutes. But yeah, let's start. Okay, so what in general is the big data science process? We have several steps. First, we need to collect the data. And the data comes with a huge variety from huge variety of sources. And it's with huge volumes and very high velocity. And the data comes mainly from three sources, like three types of sources. Machinery data, which is all kinds of devices generating huge amount of data that needs to be collected because it's really important, this data. And until recently, this data was lost in the space and nobody cared a lot about this data. The other source of data is organization data. This data is structured data because organizations are structured. This is all kinds of reports, all kinds of customer data, orders data, products data, so on and so forth. And the third source of data is human-generated data. This is everything that we generate in internet or with computers. Maybe some text, blog posts, just likes in Facebook and so on and so forth. And all this data, companies really do care about this data. They want to gather it, they want to collect it, and then they want to make profit out of it. So what is the next step? Because this data comes with really big variety of shapes, and its veracity is questionable. Veracity means if the data is really a source of truth or not. Because data may be a source of truth, but it may be something that will just give us wrong perception of and wrong reports and everything. So we need to prepare the data. Then we need to analyze this data. We need to extract patterns to find trends and to really discover the value of our data. This is extremely important step. So once we gather all this data we prepare and analyze it and find the real value of the data, we need to create all kinds of reports. Because the value of the data needs to go to the business stakeholders, to the people that make our decisions about their business and that will actually earn money out of this data. So this is the last step. And then, as you can see, this process really, really begs for automation. So people are building pipelines to which the data needs to flow. And the typical pipeline contains, I personally discovered 5 steps. The first step is to ingest the data. As we have in the previous slide, it comes from different sources in different shapes. Then the next stage of the pipeline is to process the data. It needs to be cleaned and transformed, analyzed. Then the data, oh, I forgot one stage, sorry guys. The second stage is to stage the data, to store this data somewhere. Then we need to process it, then we need to group it, to expose different views of this data, so that it suits the business needs. And then we have the last stage in the pipeline, which is ingress the data, egress the data, which means how this combined data, how those views will be delivered to our customers. And here we have challenges, because it's not only the way how we group the data, how we analyze the data, but also the time, because time is really, if you have a forecast, really good forecast, but for yesterday, it doesn't matter, it's in the past. So the data must come to our customers, to our stakeholders, as soon as possible in real time. This is very important. And one of the tools that we have to achieve real time data to our stakeholders is to use patterns. And one of the probably most famous patterns out there is the Lambda architecture. How many of you guys know this pattern? Okay, I see people know it, okay. So what the Lambda architecture really is? It separates our workflow into three layers. So when the data comes, this data is duplicated in two layers, speed layer and batch layer. The batch layer needs to store the data mostly in a raw format, and it's called deep storage because this data will stay there forever. Those stores do not usually provide like updates, deletes. You just put data there and for further analysis and transformation. And we add it to the speed layer. Usually there, the data is for a very short amount of time, for example, a day. And it provides a very fast access to this data for the most recent data. So if you have consumers that really wants a real-time data, they can connect to this speed layer and get the most recent data in extremely fast manner. And we have the serving layer. So the serving layer is something that connects to the batch layer, gets their old data, apply transformation, and also provide this data for our consumers if they need historical data in, again, real-time manner, for milliseconds, seconds, and to provide them query capabilities and so on and so forth. So this Lambda architecture is a result of the need of real-time access to our data, to the insights of the data. And I'll show you here one implementation of this Lambda architecture that we are currently experimenting in our project. So what is the business case for this project? We have huge amount of devices, Android devices, communicating with the backend, sending all kinds of events that happen on those devices. And our stakeholders, they, until recently, they just lost all that data, or they, for some of that data, they were paying huge amount of money to third-party providers, just to get a little bit of insights about that these days. So they realized that this is really, really valuable for them to build an architecture that will serve their needs and will collect this data, and it will provide this data for real-time needs. For example, they want to see which device is at which location so that they can send a message to this device that, okay, you are in Los Angeles, so go visit the ocean, I don't know, something like that. So we used for this architecture Azure. Our application is hosted in Azure. And all the components here are platform as a service solution provided by Microsoft. So what is the flow in general? So as you can see, we have the devices. They are communicating with web APIs. RESTful API. They are sending those events in thousands per second to web application providing RESTful service. This web application is then sending those events to to a messaging system called Event Hubs. It's again Azure component for messaging, which is very similar to Kafka, and I'll describe how it works. But it really provides capabilities of ingressing thousands of millions of events per minute, and then provide them for streaming for other applications. Then we have a streaming web jobs. Web jobs are something that I'll describe in the next slides, but those are very, very simple control applications that you can run in Azure, and Azure will manage them, and they can stream very easily from the web hubs for really very sufficient costs. Those web jobs are splitting data into two. And the first thing that we are sending those events to Azure Redis cache. How many of you use Redis? Just a few. So Redis is super, ultra high performance in-memory store, key value store, which can be accessed from lots of applications at the same time and can handle huge amount of reads and writes in parallel. It's extremely efficient. It's an open source project, but Microsoft provides Redis as platform as a service again. So you can just ask, give me Redis, and they will give you Redis, and it will be fully managed by Microsoft. You won't care about any of those things. And the batch data goes to the batch layer where we are using another Azure component called Azure DataLakes. In the next slides, I'll also describe what is Azure DataLakes, but for the moment, just imagine that it's a huge place where you can store everything you like, all kinds of files, all kinds of shapes. It doesn't care what you got there and how big it is. From the data lake, every night we have another platform as a service component. It comes from data factories, something that Microsoft provides, which you can create all kinds of jobs that will move or transform your data to some other store. So every night, this data factory goes to the data lake, sees what is created the last day. It gets the data and it passes to Edgebase. Our colleague talked about Edgebase before me, but here we have Edgebase as a service provided by Microsoft. Again, you don't care about how to create this cluster or anything, it's managed by Microsoft. And we have RESTful APIs, which connects to both Redis and Edgebase, and expose the data as just RESTful service for data. So other web applications can connect to our RESTful API and ask, what happened to this device last 3 days? And we'll be able to answer this question in milliseconds, which is extremely great. Another thing that can be used here is for batch analysis and answering machine learning or any kind of other kinds of questions. And this is Power BI, also provided by Microsoft. Power BI can connect to Edgebase, it can also connect to Azure DataLakes, it can use a lot of tools provided both from Microsoft and from the open source world like Hive or USQL and other good stuff to connect to both those stores and to create reports out of them together with machine learning, error language, and so on. So let's start. So what are Azure Web Applications? Azure Web Applications are something that originally was called websites, but they changed a little. And it's platform as a service hosting. They provide hosting mechanisms where you can host all kinds of applications, including .NET applications. Yeah, I saw .NET, so they go together. No surprise, but also, they can host Node.js applications, and they host it really well. They can host Java applications, PHP, and Python. Actually, in our implementation, the gateway is using Node.js. Even though we are all .NET developers in the team, we decided to go with Node.js because it's extremely, it performs really great.
really great.
So most of the web developers today have to know JavaScript. It's there. And with little JavaScript skills, you can write very sufficient application that will gather those events. It will use the SDK provided by Azure to connect to the event hubs and can send those events in millions in minutes. And also, the web applications are hosting, for example, Node.js applications very well, because as you probably know, Node.js is single-threaded. So how Microsoft solved that issue, they create instance of your Node.js application per core in the web application, in this web app. So if you have one machine with 8 cores, you have 8 Node.js applications running. So those web apps, they're extremely scalable, both vertically and horizontally, and this can be done even automatically. So you don't need to care about virtual machines, about configurations, about anything. You can just say, this pricing tier, and I want to have 10 instances. And I want to have alert that will say that if my processor is used above 80% for 5 minutes, I want to have another 2 instances. And all this will go automatically. You don't need to care. And when it goes down again, they will scale down automatically. So you pay only for what you are using, which is extremely important and is one of the best advantages of platform as a service in general. Those web applications, they are optimized for DevOps. They are optimized for continuous integration. They are integrated with Visual Studio, with GitHub, and other source controls, which is extremely nice. You can just say, okay, web app, monitor this GitHub branch, and whenever I have a change in my master, redeploy it. So this is even continuous delivery and continuous deployment with no work. They're very secured, and they're PCI, ISO, and all other stuff like that compliant, which is also very nice. Of course, security is something that we need to implement as developers, as engineers in general. Okay, so this is, maybe I can tell some more things about those web applications. We have 5 pricing tiers there. They come from free, absolutely free pricing tier, but we just use shared resources in the cloud. Whatever is free, we can use it. And we can't have our custom domain. We need to use our application.azure.whatever. Then we have a basic tier, which is, then we have shared tier, which is not free, so we can use our own domain, but it's still using shared resources in the cloud. Then we have the basic tier, standard tier, and premium tier. Of course, the premium is always the best one. It provides a lot of capabilities. But most of the times, for example, we are using standard tier, which is really cost effective. And you can check it on the web, the pricing tiers, and you'll be surprised how cheap it is. Then we have the Azure Event Hubs. So Azure Event Hubs, they're highly scalable publish subscribe service that can ingest really millions of events per second, and then to stream them to multiple consumers. So how it works? They use the partition consumer pattern, in which each consumer only reads a specific subset. And we can have multiple consumer groups. Each of those consumer group will have its own stream, so we can have multiple consumers to the same stream, and they will all receive the very same events. But also we can have consumers to the same partition, to the same consumer group, and they will compete for messages so that we can achieve very high parallelism out of the box. They are very compatible with everything because they use HTTPS or AMQP protocols for publishing events. So every client that knows HTTP can send events to those event hosts, which is extremely good. We don't care if we are writing our clients in Java, .NET, Python, whatever. Every language that can talk HTTP can send events to the event hosts. The consumer of the events, they have to use this AMQP protocol, but I can tell that most of frameworks out there knows about this protocol, and there are Java SDK, .NET SDK, of course, JavaScript SDK, Python SDK, so it's really available. And there is already SDKs for those best-known streaming solution out there, like Storm, Apache Storm, and Spark. So you can download the SDK Spark streaming and just attach to the hub, and you start receiving all those events. And they're extremely cheap. So just for $11 per month, you can create Event Hub that can start receiving 1,000 messages per second or 2 megabytes per second, one of those conditions. And you'll pay additionally 3 cents per million of messages. Imagine that, really, this is built for big data, it's built for Internet of Things, and it's the component that I will highly recommend using. We are using those event hubs for all kinds of reasons, not only for big data, but we are using it for our event-driven architecture, we are using for our CQRS, and for everything that needs to send messages around our system. Everything goes through those event hubs, and we are paying really, really small amount. It's kind of a joke. Before that, we were using service bus, and we were paying thousands of dollars per month for the service bus. And now we are paying $100, which is amazing, really. So, Azure web jobs. What are those web jobs? So, Microsoft invented a very flexible way to run background jobs. Before that, it was a worker role that you need to do configuration, to monitor, to attach to specific events, and it was really, really, really bad. Now we have web jobs, which are part of the web application. They are free. You can have as many web jobs as you want created in one web application. Of course, they will eat the resources of the web application. So if you are out of resources, you need to scale, but you don't pay for the web jobs. They are free. They are scalable together with this web application. So first, if you have more resources in the web application, like CPU and memory and everything, they will use it. But also, they are scalable horizontally. So if you have 3 instances of that web application, you have 3 instances of your web job, which is also very nice. They're available in 3 kind of types, continuously running, on demand, and scheduled. So you can schedule this web job to run every night or every 10 minutes. Or you can tell them to run continuously. So once the job is done, it will be restarted automatically by the web application, and it will start all over again, which is very useful again. All the error handling, restarting, and everything is done for you by the web application. And also, those web jobs, they can be run, created again as .NET applications, Java application, Python script, or any executable out there. So you just deliver executable, and the framework will start executing this executable. But why I'm talking about those web jobs here in this context? Because the Web Job SDK provides something which is called Event Processing Host. This is for a .NET application. And this Event Processing Host is the best way to start streaming events from Event Hubs. It deals with everything automatically. And the only thing that you need to do is to create one method with one attribute that says receive messages from this hub. and bam, with 3 months of code, you have a streaming application, which is amazing. And as we told, they are scalable. So for actually for no price, you have a cluster of web jobs that will start streaming, which is something that with Storm, for example, you have to have a cluster with 5-6 nodes, which is really, really expensive. And there, so with those web jobs in the event processing cost, you can achieve scalability in terms of the web job itself will use multi-threading. And if you have multiple instances, you have only you have as well multiple instances of the web job. So a really huge parallelism out there for no price. And Redis, what is Redis? So Redis is high performance, low latency, high throughput, advanced key value in memory store. It's an open source project, which is managed by Azure, and is provided as platform as a service. It's both horizontally and vertically scalable, which is something with Redis, if you want to host Redis on-premise on your own virtual machines, to get a horizontal scalability will be in real troubles, because it's in memory store. But Microsoft provides Redis clusters, which can scale to 530 gigabytes of memory. So imagine it's half terabyte of in-memory bit. It's amazing. And most of the time, Azure returns responses in under 8 milliseconds. So a query for a key in 8 milliseconds for 530 gigabytes of data. Okay. Try to achieve that with any other database and you'll see. So they provide replication, which is very nice, because in memory stores, they crash. Like every other computer out there, Redis also crash. And if you have everything just in memory, you are in trouble. But this is why Microsoft provides replication. And if you have cluster, it will be replicated. So there is guarantees that you have very big service level agreement out there. And Redis provides numbers of data structures, so not only key value, but apart from that, they provide hashes, lists, sets, and sorted sets. For example, we are, for our big data solution, we are using lists. So we have devices as device IMEI for, as a key, and then we have lists of events that happens for that device in the last 24 hours. And the best thing about it is that you can, when you're creating this list for this device, you can specify how long you need it there. For example, when we are specifying that it needs to live 24 hours. And bam, every evening, all the data for that device is just gone. You don't need to take care about it. It's done automatically for you, which is also something very nice. Less codes is always better.
I have one question.
Yes.
Is there any delay between data is disappeared and in lists?
So how we are doing that? We are specifying that the key must live up to 00 at 12 o'clock. And after 00, this key is deleted automatically, and next key that we are saving will create new list. It's that simple. So how Redis is working underneath, when key is expired, the next action to this key deletes the key. And if the action is to add to this list, it creates a new list. So it's that simple.
So as I understand, it's no delay.
Absolutely no delay. Mm-hmm. And thank you for the question. And now about Azure DataLake. So Microsoft actually has these data lakes for quite a long time, but it was internal project. And recently they announced it and they released it, although it's still in preview, we are already using it. It's built on top of Hadoop. It's using Hadoop distributed file system and works with everything that is in the Hadoop ecosystem. It provides unlimited storage, and pay attention on the unlimited. So how Microsoft are saying, we can either run out of storage or you can run out of money, but they guarantee that you'll run out of money first. So it's unlimited. It really do not care about the size of your account, the file size, the amount of data that can be stored, or anything. You just flush files there, and it will get them, eat them, and they'll stay there forever. It can store trillions of files, and single file can be greater than a petabyte, which is, as they say, 200 times larger than other cloud stores. So it's really amazing. Data is stored in a durable fashion, so it's replicated 3 times, so it's really durable in the universe of this data center. So as long as your data center is there and there is no tsunami or anything, you are in very good position. And it's built for running large scale analytic system, which require massive throughput to query and analyze large amounts of data. So really, application, they have even their own language, USPL, with analytics job that you can create hive-like queries that will run and do read from the data lakes, and it's huge space there. We won't be able to go over it today, maybe next conference, just for the data lakes. Apart from that, it's designed to handle huge amount concurrent write operations, which is something that Hadoop in general is not really good at. Hadoop is better in single big operations, like you can write batch of data, but data lakes are handling this problem, so they are designed for multiple concurrent writers there who will write data in incredible speed. And also they're very cheap as well. The pricing tier is currently changing, so I was decided to not include the pricing there because they are changing. But currently you are paying, I believe, 7 cents per gigabyte or something like that. It's very cheap. Okay, so enough with data lake. What is the data factory? So data factory is cloud-based data integration service that automates data movement and transformation. So those services, they need to be used as Microsoft really encourages. Whenever you have jobs that needs to run on some schedule, to connect to some kind of store, to do some transformation, and to move the data out of this store to another store. They're very sufficient as well, and they have very, very rich functionality, because first there are activities to connect from known to Microsoft stores. You can also use HDInsight, and I'll mention what is HDInsight, and to have all kinds of Storm, Spark, Hive, Peak, all kinds of jobs there. But what is activity? So the data factory works with activities, and those activities actually define a transformation or movement action, and then those activities are combined into pipelines. The output of one activity can be input for the next activity. So you can have a real data pipeline. And they operate on slices of data, just little portions, so they're effective. And the huge benefit about this data factory is that they can work with HDInsight. So what is HDInsight? HDInsight is a Hadoop ecosystem as a service, if I can call it like that. It's a cluster that creates several nodes, and you have types of clusters, Hadoop cluster, you can have Storm cluster, you can have Spark cluster, and which is very nice. So, and it's managed by Microsoft, and you, the creation and everything of those clusters is just a matter of clicking the 2-3 icons there, or even to be automated. And you're receiving a full-blown cluster with zookeepers, with everything. And you use the cluster, and then you can kill the cluster. And you pay only for the time of your cluster. And this is extremely nice. And you can have a very decent, for example, Spark cluster with 10 or 15 nodes for $2-3 per hour. And you can if you have a data factory that runs for 1 hour, you'll pay $3 per day for a cluster with Spark and everything that operates on real big data volumes. So data factories are very, very good technique and very good weapon in your arsenal if you want to go and work with Azure and operate on big data to transform and understand. I would personally recommend you to try Spark cluster with those data factories, and you'll be surprised how nice it works. So from the data factory, we have the batch layer, we have all the data there as raw text files, huge files, over 10 gigabytes, sometimes 50 gigabytes. We have the data factories which transform the data, removes the bad data, applies some things there, and then we need this data to be placed in a store that provides a random access in a real-time fashion. And as the previous speaker mentioned, HBase is one of those stores. Yeah, we have Kuduna, we have Cassandra, we have even MongoDB. Microsoft provides HBase as a service within HDInsight, which is very nice because they manage a cluster for you for a very reasonable price with HBase configured that can handle really massive amounts of data. And what is HBase? So HBase is an open source project under Apache, which is a NoSQL database built on top of Hadoop, modeled after Google Big Tables, and is designed for big data. To have an edge base that works on non-big data, for me, is the best. You can use some other store out there, even in memory, as we also already said, provides 530 gigabytes. But edge base is designed for petabytes of data. But in the same time, it provides real-time access to that data, and it can have billions of rows and millions of columns, because it's a big table implementation. You have key, and then you have any number of columns you want. Actually, there is a limitation, but the limitation, if I'm not mistaken, is 2 million columns. But I would definitely not recommend you to have 2 million columns in any kind of storage. In the HBase, it's really a matter of designing your keys, because the keys are everything in HBase. They need to provide information for your queries. So you can't just create auto-incremented keys. This is very, very bad in HBase. And it's bad not only because you have to query those rows, but apart from that, HBase is working with regions. And to achieve best performance, you need to split your data equally between the regions. And if you have auto-incremented keys somehow, you'll have one region with huge amount of data and all other regions will stay either idle and will do not. So really, the keys needs to be designed very well. You need to think how you query those keys. And apart from querying the keys, you can also query the column names. So how we are doing in our application is that every device sends number of types of events. And so for every key, we have the type name of the event is the name of the call. So you can say, give me only location events for this device. And all other data won't be returned, and there is no values in HBase. If you don't have value in the comb, this comb just won't be returned. So there is no nulls, which is very nice. As I mentioned, HDInsight and Azure provides HBase as a managed cluster. It's fully integrated in Azure, and it uses blob storage underneath, which is very nice as well, because first, we receive very low latency for those write and read operations to the store. Also, it's quite big. Per account, you can have 500 terabytes, but you can deal with Microsoft to provide you more if you need. So, as I mentioned, performance in order to have high throughput, you need to design your HBase very well. But apart from reading just and using HBase as is, you can use Phoenix, which is something created out of Salesforce, which provides SQL capabilities on top of HBase. So you can actually start using HBase as a regular SQL data store, which is also nice. HBase provides linear scalability, and it's strictly consistent. As you know, there is a cap theorem which says that those stores can be consistent, available, or partitioned or learned, but they can't have all at the same time. Authors are actually arguing which of those three HBase provides. It's really consistent, and it also provides availability of the data. But some say that as well, it's also partition tolerance. So I don't know, I really can't answer this at the moment. And actually, this is our implementation. And I'll leave you guys more time for questions. And I have in this presentation, I don't know if it will be spread around, but useful links about all those components, the documentation about it, and you'll be surprised by their capabilities. So thank you for that, and I'll expect questions.
Just wonder, why are you using Git? Microsoft have TFS.
Uh-huh. Well, I personally really dislike TFS. Even though I'm Microsoft architect, I believe that out there is other things that we need to be aware of. And if they suit our needs best, we need to use. No matter what kind of technology you are using or what kind of patterns you love or like, there is no silver bullets out there. And you need to be, I hope this is a little out of this context, but there is one joke that if you hold the hammer, everything looks like a nail and you want to bang it. So do not do that, never. You need to be aware about all the tools out there and to use them carefully and wisely. And Git is one of those very best tools out there. And to be honest, Microsoft use Git as well for their open source projects. Okay, thank you for the question.
Do you use some custom application to generate reports from Redis and from HBase, or you use some Microsoft tools for that?
So, for the moment, we are developing those tools. The first thing that is currently under development is to expose all that data as RESTful API, so that you can create all kinds of web applications that will connect to the RESTful API and will get data insights and will publish some JavaScript things out there. But apart from that, we are using Power BI tools for some reports. So combination, always hybrid approach. This is what I really love about architectures again. Thank you.
Is there something in Azure, like Spot Instance is in Amazon, so a node which can cost less money if for example, Amazon offers some nodes which are called support nodes. That means that you can use it, but they will be taken to you when someone wants to pay more money than you pay. Do you have something in Azure, something like this, support nodes?
Take some spot instances and we are setting some limit for price for that instance, and if it's available, we can spin up and use it.
Okay, so everything in Azure, it's your choice when you use it as platform as a service, whether you want to have auto scaling or you want to have some limits, but they are very careful of charging you for something that you are not ready to pay. So I don't know if I understand the question correctly, but
as I know, in Azure we just have like this spot instances.
I hope I was able to answer.
Thank you for the presentation. These are very good news for .NET developers, I believe, that we can join Big Data world. So, great job this time. I wanted to ask you if you know if there are any other projects in soft source that are using .NET Stack for Big Data or planning to use, or, I don't know, is there a competency for that?
So, currently I'm trying to build a community around .NET and Big Data. And it's hard because usually when it comes to big data, people are very Java oriented or Python oriented. But I believe that we need to use all kinds of tools, as I mentioned. And Microsoft is investing a lot in big data. Most of their tools like Storm, Hive, Peak, inside HBase, you can use .NET to build Storm applications. You can use .NET to build custom PIP things and Hive functions. So .NET is more and more available in the big data world. Apart from that, Microsoft has USQL language, which uses SQL-like language combined with .NET applications, which is also very good news. So for people that believe that C-sharp is a nice language to write, there will be opportunities to them to dive into big data stuff as well. Because big data, guys, it's everywhere. And if you build a web application or any kind of distributed application, this application generates big data under the hood. And clients, they realize that this data needs to be gathered and needs to be analyzed, and they will earn money out of this data. So .NET developers need to be prepared that they will face big data. We can't escape from that. And rather, we need to be prepared, especially as a software, because we are engineers that consult our clients in their journey for earning more money. Okay. Thank you for the question. Yeah, I know about that.
Also, I'm going to upload all presentation files and videos to our Peacemaker site and YouTube channel. And Anya is going to send links to the presentations either. So you're going to see it however you want.